Again, welcome to Seek Edge Ashep public lecture series. Many of you know me. I'm Chip Srin. I'm Seek Edge program coordinator. And it's good today we have Stephen and Malinda from Ashep to join this lecture as well. Let me give a short introduction to Phally's lectures and his short biography in here. As you know, he talks on this geography in Cambodian Golden Age music. And during the Golden Age, Cambodian Golden Age period, Golden Age and post-Golden Age as well. And I won't talk much on this abstract because you all have this flyer. And I just mentioned a few words that I'm sure Phally study on this Cambodian music during this Golden Age period and how it was used thereafter. It's a very interesting topic because as Cambodians, music that left behind from this Golden Age, as Phally put it in this abstract, is that they are all, you know, very nice music to me at least, and it describes about the landscapes, about the provinces, the name of the provinces, you know, the beauties of Cambodia, and Phally will talk about this and link this to how the Cambodian modern state begins, link it with the power and culture of Cambodia. And I really look forward to that, frankly. I myself am very much interested in this topic. And Phally, as a person, is a PhD candidate in interdisciplinary arts at Ohio University in the States, and he's currently on CH PhD fellowship as well. And without further ado, the floor is yours, Phally.
Thank you, Steve. Thank you for a question. Do you have any recording devices? It's turned off only. I think two that I agreed to is just this one. And also, TKS is recording. I had some issues in the past at a couple of conferences where I gave a presentation and I didn't give permission for my research to be disseminated, and it was disseminated just without my permission. And I was really angry because I was looking for it to get published. It didn't get published. So I guess only documentation is just this one here, right, which I signed my contract, my name in blood, in green paint, and also the recording. I guess this is it. I actually like for us to be a bit closer. If you could, those in the back, there's two nice seats here. You know, they're not padded, but you know, near am I. You could just come up here because I've really developed a kind of way of engaging with my material. Not as just a one-directional thing. I feel like it's better if we just get. Or, you know, I just can't move this desk.
No, I want to be closer, I just want to keep some space
for the people. Yeah, this is Cambodia after, right? 6 o'clock, 27. A little bit before I start, I actually wrote out my talk because a lot of criticism about this type of platform is that it doesn't seem coherent. And when my research is not coherent, it's difficult because it comes out of a history that, you know, many people chip it out as being a recent history, you know, death, genocide, and stuff. And the reason why I focus on such a this, you know, moment of golden age is because I'd rather celebrate, you know, things like that. So enough suffering in the world going on currently, and enough of everything else, you know, that happened recently, to always think of Cambodia as just a place we can go and see some temples and, you know, some skulls. And that's why I always put in my my applications for fellowships that I'm not concerned about genocide, I'm not concerned about KR, I've got a whole bunch of people doing all that stuff. I'm rather concerned about music and art, because my study is in art history. My prior study was in film and media, and then my middle study was in anthropology. So I've been around the interdisciplinary circle to see everything, which now I arrive to a point of critical studies, political science, cosmology, and just this, I think the most important thing that I think grad students don't have is common sense, accessibility. There's not much to my research other than just listening to the songs of the Golden Age, finding motifs, finding themes that are very frequent, and then using my language ability to read beyond just those lyrics. Transcription, translation, and the most fun part is getting in touch with Cambodian artists. My teacher right now is at Bayon. He is a judge for this kind of state, you can say, television thing about Cambodian music. So you have a bunch of contestants, just like, Cambodia got traditional idols, right? And I attended them last year, and this year they had another round, and every time I'm always struck by how much is put into such a production of history, right? And I'm always struck all the time, but I'm always happy to be around just older, the older artists who are still playing the music. I mean, they come on bikes, they come on, mototoks, they don't come in big cars. They carry the instruments. Their instruments are just, things in their life. So I find it very empowering that me, so lucky to be around my teacher, who is a master of his time, to be around all these other people who I keep asking him, who is he? Oh, that's my nephew from the States. Not even his nephew, I'm just a student. And it's like, is he Cambodian? Yeah, he's Cambodian. Does he know that I'm talking about him? Yeah, he knows. So, but let's get this party started. Not personal stuff. I have written up my presentation along the line of having some examples. I stopped using PowerPoint, stopped using Presio. A whole bunch of kids are doing that nowadays. So I'd rather just have, hear myself speak, I guess. I'm going to play the first song. And the first song is not about land or nation yet. It's just a good song that gets me in the mood. It's in Cambodian. I didn't even buy the translation because the expectation of these songs and understand what they're saying in Khmer is something that I don't even understand fully. That's why I do translation myself of the songs. But for some of us, we will get it. And some of us, just pretend you get it. And then we'll talk about it for a little bit. Keep in mind of the double entendre in this. I was talking to somebody about Pan, he said, those are metaphors. Cambodians use metaphors all this time. Yeah, I know, they use metaphors because that's my research. But they use double entendres. Right? Trying to find the right, double entendre is a French thing, right? And I'm trying to find the right word for it in Cambodian to have that meaning, but I couldn't.
Can you explain double? I don't understand.
It's dos entendre. I don't know, my French is so terrible. But basically, I don't want to get too raunchy. It's basically double meaning.
Okay.
Not metaphor. Metaphor represents something else. Yeah. Double meaning, meaning the word itself is a play on the language.
Okay.
The language acts as a tool, right, in which that the person who uses the language can either convey it as directly or in the sense of what this presentation is going to talk about, is the apolitical usage of the lyrics. So when I say double entendre, it's to pay attention to what is being said and just rethink a little bit what is being addressed. Alright, so I'm gonna play it. I have my shout out to my brother. He let me borrow his Bluetooth speaker because I left mine in the States. And oh, by the way, I really want to really give a thanks to CKS. So it's hard being a grad student, especially such a grad student with such type of research where people don't fund you so much. And that's the Social Science Research Center, whatever, in New York. Some people just don't find this stuff interesting more than the genocide. But just happy that CKS platform just opens something else. Or, in other words, you can find somebody talking about Korean music in Cambodia, right? Which is always a rage here. So.
Mm-hmm. But what it signaled is a calling
to a tradition that's changing for the moment. Very soon we're going to service that shows the bus. But that's a difference in the, you know, maybe kids there around can bring their, you know, cheap pants and those, you know, jeans, leggings and stuff. So that's why this is one example of what I spend my time. It's just looking at Islam beyond just this metaphor, right? And the lyrics are hard. You don't know time. That's why it's a prerequisite of time. Randall's saying, you know what he's grabbing, right? He's grabbing the thing that he was born with instead of the mechanical object to stop. But when he grabbed it, it became soft because he got caught by the police. And the police was so full of it, he just let him go. Because he understands that, like Benjamin's, you know, age of the past. Past is coming. We were here. The P and change is modernity.
Not translation of the
words. Huh? It's the translation of the words? Yeah, that's why I have to pre-warn you. That's why it's so difficult for me sometimes because, you know, I listen, I like the songs. Then when you listen to the lyrics, and then you go back and listen to the song, I have to transcribe it. It's just common sense to know what they're talking about if you're in the culture. And I'll get into this. I'll go to another portion of my thing when I write on the contemporary art. Because that's the controversy always do. I actually just want to segue real quick to show how I arrived to this kind of need to look at the data. The data for me are these songs, right? Are these songs that my parents, you know, they smuggled out of the refugee camps. These songs that, you know, used to erase on cassettes when I was, you know, before that, you know, Biggie Smalls and Pac music from the radio when I was 16 and 17. These are the songs that I'm coming back to now since my father had passed, to just bring me back to realizing that these are just not songs. These are song texts. Song texts that are not rock and roll stuff that, you know, we all are so excited recently about documentaries. No. It's a song text that are just beyond, a little bit beyond that scale that's our often community of, you know, rebellious opinions. But no, this is a type of song text that is imbued to the mythos, the myth of what is Cambodia. And in this myth, it helped to form the nation and help erode the colonial state or the memory of the colonial state. Penny Edwards, you know, book, Corporation of the Nation, one of my favorite books I use a lot in my writing. I really tried to think through all the material. See, that just can't be. There got to be something else that helped erode that whole the colonial. And then for a while, I thought it was crazy, thinking like, you know, why not? It's a, you know, refugee from Cambodia and love these songs and trying to write about them. But, you know, talking to some people, I don't know what to think about that stuff. And I come to realizing that it's not about the past, what it is, it's what the past accomplished at that moment. It's a synchronic moment, that's the word they use. It's a synchronicity, a moment in which that it happened. So when Cambodia became independent in 1953, it didn't happen in 1953. No, that music was starting already before. The king decreed officially the musical program, right, in his palace in 1945. First radio transmission came out in 1969. But before that, gramophone was a very simple thing. By the time the gramophone came into being, it really changed Cambodian poetry because now you have about 2.5 minutes to write your songs. And what other way to write a song can go back into the Cambodian poetic structure that we use? Okay, now. A little bit problematic, another chapter one thing, I won't get into it because, you know, I have to talk to my teacher more about this thing. But, okay, so I'll read you guys. Cambodian popular music survived through means of the unexpected. Through surviving records, black market refugee camp, rice war, deceptives, and through the singers and artists, Khmer people themselves who sing from their memory to what begins. This presentation consists of three parts, thesis, antithesis, and synthesis. And it's a section of my presentation on how popular music of the Cambodian Golden Age are song texts that are the biological and help bring Cambodians through during the independence era to a state of cohesion, cultivating the nation. This is something I had difficulty articulating until I came across a recent essay by Nicola Devin. It's a Devin, Professor Devin actually. Essay, Nature and the Nation, National Identity and environmentalism and Icelandic popular music, video, and music documentary opened a way for me to actually understand that I'm not alone in seeing how lyrics and the values in song text actually build to a greater importance beyond just musical meaning, but musicality. Play another song for you. And this song, when I say nation, right? This song, if you listen to this song, you're gonna hear something very. It's not difficult to hear, but to find what I'm trying to say when you listen. But listen carefully. She's not a virgin, I can't have that. She's all right, but her parents are really mean. These are all things in my culture. These are all things that appear in these promises. Values. That these songs are just entertainment. These songs, beyond that. This is the first landscape example, right? This is a geographic example. It's no different saying, Sweet Home Alabama, right? But Sweet Home Alabama is not Sweet Home Cambodia. Sweet Home Cambodia, Srok Khmer, didn't have an entity until after it became relevant and became visible that it is an entity. If you ask a Cambodian where it is from, they say, Srok. Are you from Srok Khmer? I'm in Srok Khmer, but I'm from Srok Khmer. But imagine, oh, Srok itself, Srok Khmer, is a transnational imagination, people like me, who don't belong to a province, who can't. My parents can say to them, Srok Khmer, because where they're from. Because that's where they're from. And imagine what this time of the independence era. Those melodies were from the rural and the urban. These are the two places. But it doesn't mean that the rural wasn't urban. It just means the rural was within that province itself. One can imagine. In my research, I work around two main thinking. Sociology for all the other aspects of discipline. Maurice Hallbaugh's collective memory and Pierre Nouveau's Lewis Statement of Law, English memory location. There are commentators who I hold to my group thinking in a region of, you know, of this kind of musical studies. Of course, there's ethnomusicology, political science, and, you know, hence linking up my interdisciplinary approach. But one key component is critical theory. I always love trying to find critical theory within another place. Because people always say, this critical theory is it. No. I always believe that you always have their own critical theory. And that's the more critical right there, solid text. That's very critical of culture. In addition to sociology, there is also present and valid in my talk, the work of Roland Barthes, what he says about myths and myth making. Benjamin and the Angel of History. Michael Tolson, my niece, is an affirming. And there's a couple more, but for the, you know, purpose of this, I won't really go into too much into them, but you will hear it a little bit in some way or form. Myth is the thing that I kind of work a lot in, because even though how much I love the songs and have meaning, these songs are just a distraction. Since they're supposed to be apolitical, they are there in a culturally kind of way. So, myth is one thing that I really love with Bart and Casimir and all that stuff, but you know, that's sort of the situation, right? Now, going to sociology. Maurice's Hallbaugh of collective memory and Pierre Nouveau of location memory are two sociologists that helped me think through my research, things that I did not do a lot currently in my research. But in short, collective memory is the basic idea that history comes out of memory, but it's faceted and layered with no one true narrative. It is created by the individual, the society, and the nation, and it is transmittable. It is a collective memory. We know the right person. Kind of like a colon, right? But syphilis is that it changes, becomes very organic. And memory location here, Noir's memory location, for me it's interesting because with his notion, we put ourselves, our knowledge, our history, and our experiences into objects. And in his case, he was doing French nationalism. And his body of work concerns about monuments, places, and objects towards a collective understanding of community. Now, we go to Hegel, right? But we're not going to go in that direction. Not Hegel. But for him, his concern with French nationalism follows what I am following with terms of popular culture. One of my favorite books is Fragments of the Nation by Chatterjee. He writes about the Bengali Mountain. He writes about the Bengali Mountain as being an elite popular form of way to pull away from the colonial connection. The elite use the Bengali novel to engage and communicate ideas of the political change that go on, independence. So for him, he has this wonderful two cents out of the whole book that I will always remember is this, that popular culture is an excerpt of generation. And with that one section, I get to appreciate why I know why a lot of people in youth now love Korean and pop music. It's an excerpt of the generation that they will never experience. Such a perceived sense of beauty, such a perceived sense of freedom, and such a perceived sense of security. To copy is one thing. To alter is another. That's Michael Tolson, right? He says, alternity takes us the dominant power and the subaltern or the subordinate taints it and makes it their own. So popular culture. And so when, with this in mind, with that book, with Chatterjee's book, I thought, well, I started to think that I always advocated modern golden age popular music as something very different, but I realized, no, it's just one moment. But it's a very important moment because that generation is concerned with independence. Freedom. Also, working at this, I follow John Fisk's
work on popular culture and the idea of expropriation. The process by which mass culture commodities are changed or remade to one host culture to explain the ongoing struggles between the dominant and subordinate groups in popular culture. So in the case of, say, hip-hop, American hip-hop, the idea of taking disco music and turning it into or songs by sample. In the case of genes, right, when he writes about his work on popular culture, that genes were once not highly regarded, but then when it became high fashion, became part again of the dominant culture's way of controlling existence. One of my favorite Russian folk is Bakhtin. Writes, memory is in memoirs and autobiographies under a specific source of memory of one's contemporary and one's own self. It is a de-heroic moment, the memo that is an element of the mechanical of memory itself. And in this section, it is non-monumental, meaning it has no force. It's attracted to all power. And as a result, personal memory without pre-existing chronological power, bound by the term of a single personal life. What does that mean? That means when memory becomes imbued in things like music, it tries to move in the direction of having no power at all. And you say knowledge is power, right? And Foucault says it, right? You have knowledge, you have power. But what happens is that when people start to say they are the one that brought the music, and I'll go, it's a little bit controversial, and don't be mad at me about this. Because in my writing, I write about subordination of sequence, domination of arts in Cambodia at that time. And in this, I write that the appearance of a national art was only capable by other components when art was open to space in which the king was no longer in power in the link. The national dialogue in thinking was only possible when other people's work became popular, not his own work. And that's when the motif of land and geography and popular song most of the things start to appear so badly. My theory is that when Cambodia became independent in 1953, it was already using art as a power of decoration of the formation of his identity, maintaining a continuality to the past, which gave Cambodia his past, that colonial past, which he's trying to get rid of, or even rid of, and gave Cambodia the perceived strength of a new, distinct, modern mythology. Namely, it was achieved to its notation of the landscape, religion and culture, and the importance of what is modern Cambodian tradition at that time. The consequences of modern pop music in the Golden
Age. Excuse me, can we support it? I think not only me.
Okay, that's fine. I could have slowed down, but it came at 6 o'clock exactly. That would be fine. So I'm trying to not, keep it by 9 o'clock and all this stuff. But yeah, no problem.
Thank you.
See how I lost the spot? Okay, excuse me. The consequences of Cambodian popular music in the Golden Age is a clear marker to the national identity. First, the cosmopolitanism of Cambodian popular music works against the idea of Cambodia as a state belonging and owned by a large degree of power, and makes a distinction of the nation itself. Some Cambodians directly attribute their pride in their old provinces through these songs, through their mention, and their increased national through the local profile within these popular music and industry of the Golden Age, certainly through the open free airway brought by radio and gramophone records. The success of popular music this era had the isolated effect of travel for Cambodians, for which Cambodians, really enough, engaged in indirect tourist industry when this music came out. They started to travel to the provinces. They started to affirm things that they only heard through going to the temple, through creation stories. Tung Sung Po, right? You got to go here. Looks like a book. Because it's totally a book, right? The pop music helped to increase the visibility of Cambodian locales themselves. And the music provided a resource and free, secure platform to those who listen and look for confirmation of the spaces they belong in and what they were hearing. When you think of the modern nation, in some sense, of the great work by Anderson, of it as being an imagined community. A group of people who desire to be self-governing often claim to be within a shared historical territory, within a shared historical beliefs, myths, and memories. And these are communicated through cultural artifacts, the processes. And one of the most important things, relic, and in the case of Cambodia, what is a relic? Hence, it's the first art form recognized and the teaching of Cambodian traditional art out of some form that would be the most important and the most vital. The marking of the territorial borders is remarked within these populous songs of the Golden Age. Hence, when a land is marked as territory to name, they also mark a shared history of not one people, but the community, their province, their geography, and then the country itself. The link between music and land as a historical entity belongs to the Cambodian people, as is evident in the alignment of the nation with the land and with the natural features of the landscape. One means by which nation constructs themselves is given by nature rather than it being defined by language. This is Vidun's quote, right? That's his quote. Very strong quote. He just says, when you go to a land, it's not political. It's a land, it's old land. Well, not now, right? But Vidun's thesis on Icelandic popular music, I feel it strongly against the religion. As the Golden Age of Cambodian music created an identity drawn from the land itself. Language and literature that creates the idea of the natural relation between the land, the territory of the nation state and the nation, and the imaginary between the people, inhibits itself and conceals the political power that were at play at that time. Meaning, everything the king was doing on the political one, everything that the Khmer Sarayi was doing, everything that, Sangat Khan was doing, all these people who were pushing for Cambodian independence, even the king, the prince himself, Sisavat, what's his name? I wrote it in here, father of Cambodian democracy. Him himself, right? All these individuals were functioning within the political domains. You have the artists functioning outside of the political domain. Even ironically, they came from within the domains of the king himself, right? You can see it. It's very messed up, right? Blows my mind sometimes. The Cambodian nation. Connection with the landscape and nature has always been an important aspect of Cambodian national identity, and is found throughout much of this music. Cambodia's distinctive topological features frequently appear as part of the Cambodian rural and urban landscape, and the ideology of pure Cambodia, free and pure Cambodia, not a post-colonial Cambodia. These topological features are used to claim a distinct character, not just for the land itself, but for the nation and other aspects of daily rural life and culture. Between the rural and urban, central to the ideas of nature articulating in Cambodian popular music is the contrast between this country and the city. These two boundaries is what has isolated, for the most part, the understanding of Srok Khmer, which can be understood as a response to the isolation from the rural from the urban and the domains in which politics and other things occur when Cambodia was a protectorate. Cambodia is presented as a place in these songs as rural and Buddhist, full of tradition, but on the other hand, moving toward the direction of the modern nation, occurring at an exponential rate in which different locales of Cambodia experience different forces. Hence, the Sikho man seeing the vows of the young ladies sitting in front of him. Hence, going around to many provinces and seeing that there are provinces and names of themselves. Quick anecdote, my dad, he bought the ball when he was younger. He heard of Angkor Wat. He never seen Angkor Wat. He stayed in Phnom Penh until when he was able to come back in 2000. He actually visited Angkor Wat for the very first time. This is how those geographies are dictated. When I said earlier, these songs opened up the indirect tourist industry, because those who became cosmopolitan people at that time were able to travel these places. They were able to travel to Phnom Penh, as he's most seen about. They were able to travel to Phnom Penh. Right, and have those delicious crabs that are going here. So not just for land, but for the nation, music, and other aspects of life. Okay. I talked about Phnom Penh a little bit in its 100 years of domination as divorces because of this. We have to understand Cambodia as a territory that belonged to Thai for about 100 years, right? We do know that history. Are we? A little bit about that? Until the treaties, the Paris Treaties in 1903, I think, we turned Cambodia back. Cambodia. It's some very big thing. And few actually know about this, but if you look at another chance to change anything, look at the history of Phnom Penh itself, it was an isolated place. Because it's all by the seams. I use the word seam because I wear seams. I use higher as another modification. Contemporary Cambodia's construction of identity right now therefore strives for a balance between the idea of Cambodia's land knowledge and literature and its modern trajectory. But for the Cambodian Golden Age of art, it has been a domain for the construction of that national identity. Advances in working working with nature as it goes hand in hand. And there is no need to sacrifice that political domain because of this apolitical features. The attempt to reconcile nature and technology, tradition and modernity articulate in some of Cambodian music of that era. But it's not simply a national statement of the country's modernization. Rather, it is the way that music is made in the past as a central notion of cultural ambassadors who define a nation and shape its policies through the representation of the political activities in the realm that we call art. Basically, this paragraph, art at that time in the medium was to, you know, race survey of independence was that it was all of independence from architecture to painting to Macau to theater to music. They were independent because I was asked by Terry, you know, when did Cambodian music come to one tradition of music? I said, no, it's pre-existing music that became categorized. So that's something else, another chapter. Now this is the fun part. I'm almost done with that. Art has to be understood in Cambodia is out of memory. That's how they teach you here. It's by memory. They teach by memory and practice. I get yelled at for not using my brain because art is not through memory. Now, not memory that you think and know recently of the genocide and all that stuff. Because they are teaching that right now. But a much more deeper social memory. Collective memory, again, all, to which a select few artists who has chosen to be the social breakers to those who can enjoy. However, overlooking this is participating in the memory, meaning you can be a person who enjoys music, and you can be a person who understands music. Memory in this state of Cambodia is not transnational, it's not traumatic, and it's not diaspora. If you consider what is traditional art. Even though other might say, like, you know, it is, but what we must understand is the synchrony of the exact moment in which that art became formulated officially as part of the national heritage, 1953. In verse 1, 1965, the school rules was then done. What we must understand is synchrony is that for us to look at art as being transnational means Cambodian history as being transnational. So what people are using now, contemporary art, it does not give birth to the art of Cambodia. It gives birth to an international heritage of art. Cambodian traditional art falls into line of traditional because of the process of cultivating an experience that's only located and experienced in Cambodia. So you're a contemporary artist in Cambodia, you're a contemporary artist. The only way it makes sense is because you were born here, you grew up here, you've seen everything here. Not because you're a refugee that grew up in America or France, Australia, and then, you know, learn, you know, art and then come back to Cambodia and now you're, you know, have your stuff, you took that moment. No. That's not Cambodian art. You have art. Cambodian art is through experience, through learning. It's not a workshop you take a Cambodian classical dance and you learn three or four poses and all of a sudden you make a contemporary art piece. No. The monkey builds a bridge to Lanka or Kathmandu looking for the Savannah child. That's what he does. He goes through the whole process of memory. So the article is what I did, requires in this history the charismatic leadership. And in this case, the charismatic leadership is Sino. Because Sino is the guy. Sino is the person that made Cambodian people take note. And you can talk about it in a way in which that, well, he is the king. Right? Everybody looks for the king at that time. That's why he's highly celebrated. That's why he has a monument at the independent monument, next to the monument. However, being charismatic is only one aspect, because it falls into how art is today. Who are the people that are innovating traditional forms of Cambodian art? It's hard to identify charismatic leaders when charisma has been sold out for the system of the capital system. However, given how Sino is just a hobby and he was the gold standard He is a ghost man. And when he started making music, and he started opening the most which music he made, other people started making music too. But the problem with the rise of scene of the system, when other people's music became popular, he no longer became popular. And that was one of the issues that I struggled with, because for whatever, who came first, who created manifestation team, art became popular in a sense because of subaltern. The people who were not from the king's world weren't able to speak, weren't able to make music, were able to go out about and paint, make sculptures. One aspect of our research is understand the economic system of foreign artists in the traditional foreign artists. A G, right? That's your expert. Took that at a job, right? Fire contract. But in a sense, those economies are so blurry that you're still with the state. Because a traditional Cambodian artist is always with the state, ruthless with the state. You could talk the conservatory of artists that belong to the ministry, it's part of the state. So for you to be a traditional Cambodian artist, you have to be part of the state. Split. With this music at that time, it wasn't that political because the state was informed it or just formed the music. It's quite simple. So this collective memory, this process that only happens here in Cambodia, so Cambodia diasporas, Cambodia diaspora societies, this is why I call it a xenophobic condition. Xenophobic, right? You don't like anybody else, you just like your own people. It's not racist, not discriminatory, xenophobic. It's because in such places as Cambodia, like any other place, it's to safeguard one own rights. And once you lose culture and arts, you don't have anything else. By being xenophobic, you are actually keeping yourself alive. It's not just safe motives, everything else. That's why UNESCO designates things as cultural heritage. We give people identities. To me, myself, I don't really like Cambodian classical dance. Too slow. Music not too good. I like folk dance. I like, peacock dance. I love all that stuff. I love bong bong. Always fun with Cambodian music. Pretend like I'm shooting with beer, give money. And this is not an example of just current controversy affecting cultural others, but other ongoing and still hurtful memories like Bithia, Play the Ball, and the Go On. Oh, those rich controversies. Safeguarding is in the simple terms, but to understand Cambodia as a modern state of nation is just a recent phenomenon of which it is. And in Cambodia, you have to consider that even Srok Khmer itself, and I told you, it's just quite destructive term, was being referred when Srok Khmer left how we love so much, Cambodia. Love that word, Cambodia. Cambodia. For me, it's always Srok Khmer. Srok Khmer is mostly used by those who do not possess that exponential experience that people in Cambodia already have acquired and experienced. And I actually ask Cambodians on a holiday, right? Many holidays, where are you going? Go Srok Khmer. I'm going back home. It's my country. Srok Khmer becomes a transnational term, but Srok Khmer itself denotes more of the larger idea at hand, which is the country of Khmer, not Cambodian, not Cambodia. We hear Srok Khmer in these songs because Khmer at that time heard it and seek out the country that is Cambodia and turn it into Srok Khmer. And not just one ratio, but for what I call a moment of cultural collision by a French, the Russian philosopher, Lachman, who said that in this case, the allegiances are collided when the provinces meet the world. Culture collides and new things come up. New things. So all that stuff that was happening in the Phnom-Penh going to, let's say, Bangkok. Wow, you guys are fighting for independence? And it didn't come by just tourists, the Cambodian tourists around the country. It came through the radio waves. The changes that they were. Oh, that's 10 minutes? Okay. So many times to take part. How are you doing?
The time is
arrived, huh? No, we, kind of stuck sometimes.
And then that's faster. Then that's faster.
They say,
I'm not looking at that clock.
You're looking at it.
I'm looking at that clock.
I hope you enjoy what you think a little bit. Yeah, right. Okay, so what does that do? Okay. Music, in all universal sense, is a sensation. When you hear music, you actually feel music. That's how you hear words. Vibration hits your eardrums. Biological functioning makes you connect to an experience, whether it's language, right, or musicality. That's what music is. It's not sound. Say, well, what are your five senses? Hearing. Hearing is not sense, in my opinion. Hearing is one part of touch. So, play another song here. This song is by the king himself. The king wrote the song. I double checked the song itself because I had a little bit of a problem. This is Vacation in Cap. Vacation in Cap. Did the artist make the Cambodian musician participate in the modernization of the song this time, or did it come from outside? My teacher told me the song was made by Moses, by the king, when he did it in 1945. He initiated music in Cambodia as being, you know, something that, you know, was going to explore. He brought it into the streets. But when he initiated, what happened is that within the veil, within the royal palace, they were looking at modes. So when you hear these songs, you hear, you know, these traditional, these traditional, drum beats, and you hear traditional instruments. These are modes that became part of this dialect. Right? That's how he explained to me. He's like, and then, however, when these musicians left the royal palace and he did the whole thing, they made music like this. They experimented with guitars, right, violins, piano, new instruments that were coming in. And the magic is this, though. He says, in the end, it's still Khmer. Because why? Those musicians, they needed to be trained at the Royal University in Khmer arts. And that's very important. That's why I say, rock and roll music sounds like, something from, the U.S. No. That rock and roll music you're hearing sounds Cambodian. Because it's Cambodian. Now, Somai is a funny word. Somai CDI. But one word that I really love, I spent 2 years researching, was Apollo. You ever heard that word before? Apollo? Probably heard it before. Apollo.
Somai Apollo.
Somai Apollo. But let's look at Apollo a little bit, right? That's the magic word. So then you got 5 minutes left to just do these last two songs?
Yeah.
I'm all done. And this is also a song, one of my favorites, it's only 2 minutes, so. In Cambodia. You go find a record of a bone record, you see? The Apollo spacecraft. That's what a bone is. A type of technological modernity.
No, we have some computer.
Some iPhone.
Some iPhone.
But think about that. This is 1961, right? Financial Apollo. Yenji Lan. In a sense, it's no difference than now, right? 7 years into the country. So, I spent 2 years looking at this word itself, trying to figure out, does Apollo mean, say, the Greek gods, could also study Greek mythology? And my teacher told me, no, Apollo is another word from where that deals with knowledge. And it was used in the song to show these pieces of Cambodia as technologically advanced. Last part. Now, that's actually it about destination. I mean, I've been running around this thing where putting examples like there is the landscape being used. And the lyrics part also really have a strong understanding of time to see. But for those who do hear the places, Phnom-Penh. It's a small bridge in Bang Hong, but it's a famous bridge in the song. So when you go to Phnom-Penh, it's like from here to there. But for the imagining of people, who hear the song, this is a really important bridge of love. In the song, he talks about the girl that he likes, his mom doesn't want him to ever see the daughter again because he's just a laborer. And the bridge is the only bridge that knows the story. So he said, Nick doesn't even kill me. If you know my story, do not tell me. I'm going to end this right now with this one last one. And I started something without landscape. I want to end with something not about landscape, but it's just as important. Like, what do you want to eat? What food do you want to eat? She goes to the list of all these Cambodian foods that I know, and you know, right? And you know, it feels good to know that I know these foods. Take out landscapes. I know these landscapes. And then he goes at the end, I want special food. What's the special food? The food that you have. She said, stop playing around. It's not about sex force. This is what it's actually about. That's what I'm talking about, talking earlier about, leaving behind beyond the double meaning. It's about her love for her husband. She's willing to cook all these things to make him happy. And all he just wants is to have still that love that she gives him. It says, my hope drop cruelly. Right? Not my hope love you. Drop means to attach, right? When you love somebody, it's attached to that person. So it may seem wrong to you, oh, he wants some sex, oh yeah, party time, but no. He doesn't want anything from her. Only the continued love that she has for him by offering to cook all these things for her. Now, people can argue about that's not his something. No, it's a bad person. Consider the word that's used and stuff. Josh. You're born with love, but it becomes attached to a person. Also, I have some other pages, but it's okay. We did my dissertation like a couple of years ago. But that's it.
Thank you. So, I think we still have time, and that's much faster than the time that any one of us have. But we still have about 20-25 minutes for discussions. If there are any questions or comments, then yeah.
Yes, Phally, thank you, very good. We know each other 10 years in 2006, and for my exact paper for my master degree also. So I have some comment and question to you. You said about your mom about isolated people to anchor, and then the reason that you said that this is because of geography, this point I disagree with.
Okay.
Because in the time, you see the era, Cambodian people are a culture, not culture of traveling. Same my mom. If the culture of traveling, it doesn't exist. It's different from my mom and me also. Even I have money, my mom will go to Bangkok, I pay. I visa, everything. But she said, no, I don't want it. And compared to the travel. So this is a different time. Second thing is about the transportation. At that time, I think it's a bit difficult for the road and on field, or difficult from the mountain to not too far, but people difficult to access. And about economy also. And the third thing is the area of maybe this happened, I think, pressure from the politics or civil war starting. So maybe that's why the thing is different from now. She wanted to go to the test. The second thing is about the point you show a lot in Button Ball, and you say that the second song, you say that the geography, the two guys who are from different space, and then they mocking other COVID. This is the point critical that at the time, at the era, you should search more. That the during CNU era, the Phnom-Penh is one of the province developments. So that's a focus people every Phnom-Penh and Thailand. Thailand is not a province, you see, it's not a Phnom-Penh. Yeah? And then the second thing is the author. A lot of author and a singer come up from Phnom-Penh. And also example Phnom-Penh Chien. You know the guy.
Yeah,
he just passed away. Yeah. But the guy is emotional writing author to sing good songs a lot. So that's the point you should show the people that investing in Phnom-Penh, not just like oh geography, no. It's not like that. And the second thing, you said that the fall down between the era, the good song, describe about culture or about geography, but different now from like emotional song more. But you should show the song that era, and you should a few presentations with your new soft examples to create, you know, but all blah blah blah, you know, it's different, it's completely cold, but you should show a limit one or two songs, let the audience understand what your presentation is wanting, okay? Another one is, it's okay.
Just to be clear, my research is only on the Cambodian Golden Age music and nothing else.
That's what the dates.
What is the Golden
Age? Cambodian Golden Age music is roughly around the time of the movement towards independence and post independence. So you have far in 19. You want to count, well, no, 1975, right? Before the Khmer Rouge. But before that, you've got to count, to me, 1950s. I count 1950s because that's when the radio becomes.
So it's 20 years of
music. 20 years of music, right? In terms of world guests, I agree with you that travel is something at that time that I'm saying. What I'm actually trying to say is that the roles are difficult. They're all difficult now, and they're all difficult back then. But the thing is that these songs, they promote a visibility of these spaces. And that promotion for those who have the cards, which were the elites, right? They were able to go, right? They were the ones who were the cosmopolitan, let's say, were the cosmopolites, who had the means to get to these places. But when they went to these places, the contact with the individual in these provinces is that moment of realization that we are not just one province. They go over there, you guys are from Phnom-Penh. You know, Biden is supposed to lie. You gotta see Jai. I want to go spin with you. Get that. And people in the province themselves, when they hear on the radio is free. They know already, wow, they just mentioned that. It feels good. What I'm saying is this, the awareness that these songs addressed in Cambodia at that time was important in understanding the concept of nation. Even though for many who could not travel, did not have the means to travel, that didn't mean they couldn't imagine it. They couldn't imagine being in Angkor Wat at that time. Angkor Wat is really popular because the French chopped down some trees and found it right there in bushes. Everybody moves there all the time. But the reimagining of it in the song was what made people like my dad think that, oh, I wish I had a chance to go to Angkor Wat, but I can't. Now, flash of 2007, I can go to Angkor Wat and see. So yes, we know that you want to help me edit my dissertation, right? Because I help edit your thesis, so.
One question. When you call it Golden Age, you refer to, this is a, why did you decide to use Golden Age instead of Songkum?
Songkum, no, you don't use Songkum.
Is it you who choose?
No. This is a term that many Cambodians know as the Golden Age. Right? I'm agree? All my Khmer people in the room, you agree? We know that this was the age of arts and culture. And it was spearheaded by the king. Mm-hmm. The king initiated this. You know, he set the plans for the Phnom-Penh. Got them all. You know, we made that game. Hired all this stuff. Sent people abroad. They came back with insights. And it sparked a new national heritage that coincided with the independence. So the Golden Age is not my term. No, it's a term that unfortunately, Cambodians, in Cambodia, right? Older generation.
Just one more question.
Yes,
for me, it's not clear how do you build your methodological corpus? How do you build your.
On my
father? I mean, talking about the song text, mm-hmm. It's 20 years of song text, so how do you discriminate which one you retain and which one you don't? What is the landscape of all the singers?
I listen to everything, I listen to the Khmer Rouge songs.
Oh. Can I come into that? How many songs?
I have songs.
Number of songs.
A lot. I can say. I lost count. I just listen, and I don't scream. I listen to all of them. And recently, I'm listening to a lot of Khmer Rouge songs that actually bring in. Actually, a lot also post Khmer Rouge, 1990 songs from the Ministry of Memory as well. You know, I don't do memory.
Because I think it's realistic and it would be possible to say, okay, during this period of studying, we have these singers. Mm-hmm. I think it's possible, and it would give a first picture, first landscape, and after that, so Among this, within this, I took and I said these songs because. And
I don't pick the songs. I ask my teacher for recommendations. My teacher knows the songs more than me. He knows who wrote the song, who sang the song. He knows the singer. And this is knowledge I don't have. I'm just a flaneur. In our case, I just look at things and I like. My teacher is one who say, you want to know a song about Cambodia? About Phnom-Penh? You listen to this song right here. He gave me that. I have a from that, my mythology is a selected data set, which is very familiar to Cambodians, because when they hear it, they know the songs right away. And that's where, that, to understand that, I mean, I can really care less about some people, you know, academically, like, oh, you know, why are you pick this one, you pick that? It's because my teacher told me to pick it.
So you're talking about the songs your teacher selected?
Yeah, my teacher, he's a local institute. He's a musician, he knows this song.
Yeah,
right? And I asked him through Tara, I asked him for help. He told me, listen to this song, listen to this music, go watch this. You know, come with me to the TV station, watch it, think. Because you can teach anybody, but you can't teach them to think. And that's what he says. I pick these songs for you, this is going to help you think. And when you're able to think, you can pick other songs. You know, you can pick any contract, unknown song, right, and make some nice 5-page, 10-page paper about it. But you can only pick a song that an expert, an informant, who selected you. My mythology, transcription, translation of their song as recommended by experts, Cambodian musicians, traditional Cambodian musicians. Ethnography, central ethnography, go to the location of these songs and stuff, the geography. Go to scale of E. Go to Angkor Wat. Why they learn? Talk to the people there that's still there. Right? And then my last one is watch the work. Watch the movies. See how the movies play into Cambodian traditional theater on film. See how those songs are not copying the Bollywood model, but it's actually Cambodian talking theater on film. A lot more is. This is just, you know, one of my requirements for CKS, and I don't mind. I'll be back to present more, hopefully, Steve. But this is just a drop of history that, you know, people get a little bit like, didn't address this, can't address this. And always, I found this out as a presenter, always be clear what you want to address. And I'm clear I'm set to address geography, the landscape, all of the golden age music of Cambodia.
Actually, my question connects to Eric's regarding the math and all that stuff, because I was just wondering how you were selecting the songs as well, because as I asked, I don't know, those songs are very much outside of pop region, by the adult group who perhaps are familiar with the song, so they are actually already selected. The memories, so there might be other songs that I've watched belong to this group, which actually belongs to the other group of the population, the younger and older. So when you were saying that all of these are representing the concept of nation, it can be a rich distortion when you're not actually having the whole idea of the whole song that has been previously in the lyrics. And also to connect to what you just said about the golden age, I think it depends on how you define art and character, because perhaps you can also review that during the chapter Burman 7, the Cambodian art has also been offered in terms of temples and things.
Specifically about the Khmer stuff, I'd be honest, I don't touch the Khmer stuff at all. And the reason why you can make art is selective, right? Some songs just don't make it. I'm going for whatever evidence I have from my teachers and whatever song remains from those cassettes that came out of refugee camps, from those records that are still being bought. My friend, Oracle, right? He won the Music Venture Friday, right? Talking a lot about this stuff. And he comes to agree this. None of these songs were ever selected. They survived. They survived through the memory of people who at that time, like my dad and, you know, my teacher, heard songs on the radio. These are popular songs. I'm not looking for critical songs. I'm looking for popular songs. Songs that, maybe five top songs that, you know, Cambodians will know if you say, Phnom-Penh, Phnom-Penh. Right? Phnom-Penh. Right? All these songs have something in them, right? These are popular songs. So if you give me a list of five songs, I can tell you I know the songs, because they're popular. Now, of course, there's some erasure, right? And I'm not doing justice to the people who are selected. But you know what, though, you ask anybody who are the famous Cambodian singers of then, first person they're going to say, since he's more, it's a gossip tale. They don't talk about Unity, they don't talk about Lee Seung-Won, they don't talk about Phan Rang, you know? Only Cambodians know this. So you know what, when I, not to be combative, but if Westerners and other people from the West are interested, you know, don't be interested of just, you know, the songs that we have forgotten. No, these ballads, these song texts are not forgotten at all. And they're not erased. The Grand East restored a lot of stuff, yes. But before it went out, a lot of stuff still left Cambodia. It went to Malaysia, went to France. You know, people hid them. You know, when people being purged, they didn't just bury jewelry. They didn't bury gold. They buried art. They buried the set. They buried gramophone records. Talk about that, right? You know you're going to die. You know what's happening. Can I wish I could leave something? I'm going to bury this. No. Put that record in there because I love that song. That's the song I grew up. So, I'm not being selective. Those people who pick those songs to survive, they're being selective. They pick that song because they like it. I just lay over here. And my teacher told me, you should select that song because it's the reason why that person saved that song for you to listen to. So, maybe somebody else can write a whole dissertation about all the songs, but not for me. Not for me.
This is not the point.
It's a point. There's a lot of damage.
It's another job, right?
Yeah, it's another job that is not
interesting to understand that through your teacher's point of view.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I know, he told me that. He's like, yeah. You know what? He just told me this. Holly, they just old songs. Give them up. Kids don't listen to them now. And I go, but prove you're wrong. I listen to them. I understand him. He worked with him for 10 years. He's my teacher. He's like my father. I know, but not even all fathers are perfect. We know that. Pick a song he doesn't like because a girlfriend broke up with him back then. He couldn't marry the girl he liked. That's fine. I like that song. I'll write about it. And you use that selection of song as your data. Right? There's a lot of pro to methodology. You know, give me that for 10 years of bachelor's. I know, arguing about what are your substance, what are your data selection stuff. The more you stay clear your data selection, you say these songs are selected by the informants of Cambodian artists who are respected in Cambodia and who still perform nowadays. These songs come with a level of integrity. And then people ask me, well, you know, you gotta understand some songs are gone, right? Because, you know, they're selected. Like, I understand that. I don't understand that. Don't get me with that. You know that.
It's actually not about the quality of the song.
It's about the popularity of the song. That's what I'm saying. These songs are popular. The popularity comes first. The meaning comes next. And then understanding its place in the history of Cambodia's independence, that's where I'm at. As seen through the songs. So, that's fine. It's okay.
Any other question? Maybe we can have one more. If there is any. Okay. Otherwise,
I'm done. Okay.
No, okay, good. Thank you. And you can close this. And thank you again to Phally for this presentation and everyone for coming. In fact, we have a small refreshment outside, some still coffee available at this time, and some water. And if you want to continue the discussion, the refreshment, then feel free to do that.
This is my whiskey time, though. This is my whiskey time.
Unfortunately, we don't have
any whiskey time.
Unfortunately.
Okay. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for the talk round.
Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.